If you don't mind, I'd like to step down and interact with the group. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
And thank you so much for inviting me to spend time with you and share my experiences on this very, very weighty topic, agile learning. It's a very, very weighty topic. You know, and there's a lot of theoretical underpinning to that topic. As some of you who are working on the Agile Learning group, I'm sure you've already discovered that. There's a lot of theoretical underpinning to this topic. But today, we have about an hour, hour and a half of time. So in my view, my thought process is that let's use that time to talk about real life experiences of Agile Learning in action in an actual organizational context. I would like to candidly share with you what went well in executing some of those initiatives, but equally, I think it's also important to spend time on what did not go well. Where did we fail and what could we have done better? So I think we could also spend some time talking about what didn't work, right? So that's how I was thinking this session could go. Do you have any inputs? Is that the right approach? Perfect?
Yes.
Yeah. But just to make sure that we are all on the same page, I'm going to start asking you a few questions and we'll set a little bit of context and then directly plunge into actual experience sharing. Yep. Okay, I'm going to ask you some very silly basic questions. Please forgive me. Okay. First question is, when you think of the term learning, forget agile learning for now, just learning, plain and simple. When you think of the word learning, what is the mental image that comes to your mind? What's the first visual image that comes to your mind?
Knowing the unknown.
I heard somebody here. Classroom and teacher. Yeah.
Question mark.
A question mark. Okay.
Exploring.
Okay.
Examination.
Examination. Yeah. Earning. Learning and what is the linkage to earning? It's that time of the year, sir. Yeah. What else?
Sitting before guru.
Unlearning. Sitting before the guru. Somebody who knows it all and who's going to deliver enlightenment. Okay.
School.
School. Your school. Right.
Grasping and reflections.
Grasping and reflections. Okay.
Parents.
The need of the hour. Okay. Perfect. Thank you so much for sharing this. We'll go back and revisit some of these adjectives and words that you shared. Okay. Second question. So when you think of how do we identify learning needs for an organization, how do we actually decide where we want to invest our learning budget? What are some of the words or phrases that come to your mind? How do we typically undertake the learning needs identification process?
The skill gap.
Skill gap, okay. Looking at the skill gap.
New technology.
New technologies. That's awesome.
Organization demand.
The nation's demand.
Organization's
demand. Okay, from an organizational context. Job rotation. Change in market scenario. So the outside market is also sometimes a good input for your learning needs. Okay. So very industry specific and as per the requirement of the organization and the management. Okay. Okay. Third question. So when you think of somebody who's a learning professional, how many of you work in the learning space? Either directly or it's part of your portfolio? Everybody, okay. Okay. So what do you think is the most important quality of a learning professional? You could also name two qualities. You don't need to restrict yourself to one. Self-learnability
should be excellent.
That's a very good point. Good listener.
Passion.
See. Passion.
Communicator.
Communicator. Okay.
Who understands strategy.
Somebody who understands strategy. The linkage between strategy and people skills. Okay. Think of some of the best learning professionals that you've met in your life. What stood out about them?
No hair.
No hair. No okay.
Hair.
I thought no hair. Okay. No air. No air. Okay. Mm.
A leader.
Okay.
Leader.
A reader. Well versed. A reader. Somebody who knows. Okay. Knowledgeable. Good point. Okay. Last question before we get into the rest of the story. Last question is learning impact. This is like a question that's been done to death. Everybody talks about how do we measure learning impact. What are the success metrics that we should use to measure the effectiveness of learning? What are some of the measures that you can think of?
Monitoring
the learning execution process. Thank you. Anybody else?
Performance. Pre and post performance.
Pre and post performance. Yep.
Ultimate is ROI depending on the amount spent.
ROI. Right. What do we typically do when we do a learning initiative? What are the ways in which we actually measure impact in reality? Let's be honest. Did you like the facilitator smile? Did you like the chai and coffee? Yeah. Okay, good. Excellent. Thank you so much for candidly sharing your initial impressions of some of these questions. What we'll now do is very quickly introduce the concept of agile learning. I understand that for some of you it might be a new concept, so we'll quickly spend some time on the basics of it. Not too much gyan, and then we get into actual examples. Yep. I think my slides decided to. Okay, perfect. Okay. Some of you are from a manufacturing background, right? Most of you, in fact. All of you. So, what is agile manufacturing? So, in the manufacturing context, what is agile? Flexibility. The ability to respond to change very quickly. Yep.
Adaptability.
Adaptability. So really, if you look at the origin of agile learning as a concept, it started with agile manufacturing, right? As the world started becoming smaller, as globalization started happening, as the range of commercial activities that we started engaging in became broader, what happened is we realized that the lead time between manufacturing happening in a factory and actual sales happening in a store somewhere far away, hundreds and thousands of miles away, that lead time is very, very long, right? And it's not enough. And therefore, demand-supply gaps were more the norm. And therefore, we brought up the concept of agile manufacturing. And agile manufacturing, like you rightly said, is really about, I'm going to oversimplify it a bit. Suppose I walk into a store in Mumbai or Bangalore, I walk into a store, I see a range of 7 or 8 sweaters of different colors. Green, yellow, red, pink. I choose green. The guy who comes after me into the store also chooses green. So clearly, of all the sweaters that are there, the green sweater is the one that's moving the most. Now, who's going to tell the manufacturing site, which is hundreds of miles away, that please make more green sweaters? Right? So that process of making that loop, the feedback loop, faster through processes, through tools, that is really what agile manufacturing is about, right? I'm oversimplifying it a bit, but that's really what it's all about. Now, as the world grew into the technology space more and more, we realized that the same principle also needed to be applied in the software development process, right? So we started talking about agile development. So rather than doing a requirement analysis at the start of a project to death and then designing the entire project, then discovering all the bugs and then trying to fix it, In agile software development, many of you may be aware, what we really try to do is to break up the project into modules. Each module is therefore flexible. It can be plugged one over the other. And at the same time, it allows you to operate with a great deal of speed because you have many teams collaborating on the entire project, working on different modules, and everything comes together. There are feedback loops in place across modules. So that's how agile development came to existence as a concept. And now, everybody keeps talking about the VUCA world. What does VUCA stand for? I'm sure you've heard it a zillion times. Ambiguous. I think we've all heard it. It's like the latest buzzword. But with everything that's going on, there are so many black swan events that are happening. Did any of us predict demonetization? We didn't, right? And it's had a huge impact, right? If you look at even what happened with Goldman or with Lehman, any of the large banks that collapsed during the Lehman crisis in 2009, at that point of time, 2009 or 2008? 2008. At that point of time also, nobody anticipated it. We all woke up one morning and we realized that that's it. Right? The world as we know it no longer exists, right? So the world is becoming very, very unpredictable. And in that world, traditional approaches to learning therefore don't make sense. By the time a traditional training-oriented person does an annual training needs identification process, he does the performance appraisal of all his people, looks at whether Mr. X requires communication, Y requires collaboration, etc., without understanding the context of that individual and their team, and then injects them with learning, generic learning, which may not be meaningful to that individual, that is not going to work in today's world, right? Today's world is a world where the learner expects you to deliver learning to them just in time. You can't train somebody or make them learn a concept 2 months before they are going to use it. It has to be done in real time. So learning has to be delivered just in time. Learning has to be just enough. It cannot be too much, it cannot be too little. If you try to give somebody too much, if you try to give somebody too much of learning that is not relevant to them, they are going to switch off. But at the same time, if you give them too little, that's going to impact the effectiveness as well. So it's really about just in time and just enough. And the third piece is what is really unique about today's day and age. The learner also expects that learning is just for me, which means that learning cannot be generic anymore. It has to be customized to the person's context. It has to be meaningful and relevant to that individual. So a generic communication skills program and presentation skills program or Excel skills program, those days are over, right? Agile learning is really all about that. So agile learning is really about how do we actually bring in greater speed, greater responsiveness, and greater flexibility into the way we approach learning. Right? That's really what it's all about. Yeah. How many of you have heard of ADDIE? ADDIE, what do you see up there? Is anybody familiar with that concept? So if you look at how we traditionally approach learning, how would you say, if you had to design a learning intervention, can somebody tell me what would the steps be? What would you do? What's the first step?
This is the needs.
Capturing the needs, which is the A of ADDIE. So A stands for analyze, right? What would you do then after that? Once you've understood the need, what would you do?
Design.
Okay, then? Okay, develop and deliver the program, then? Okay, implement it, okay? Impact. And then evaluate the effectiveness, right? So what is, if you see that whole process, it's very linear. So you finish one step, then you move to the next step, then you move to the next step, and then you finish the entire learning loop, and then you go back and evaluate effectiveness. That's not enough, right? Because by the time you finish that whole cycle, the person's context may have changed, the person's need may have changed, and what you're delivering may not be relevant to them anymore, right? And that's where, if you look at agile learning as a concept, it is not linear, it is iterative, it is a little messier, which means that all these different phases of the process, they merge. It's not as straightforward. So I might do learning needs identification by immersing myself in the learner's context. So for instance, if I'm working with, say, my distributor sales executives and trying to deliver a sales intervention for them, maybe analyze means spending time with the person, immersing ourselves in their experience, understanding the world the way they see it, what are their challenges, and then going back, looking at design, piloting it, taking feedback. So feedback doesn't come at the end of the learning intervention, it comes at every phase of the learning process, right? Even in the analysis phase, you take feedback, right? So that's what agile learning is really all about. So it's about speed, it's about flexibility, it's about collaboration, and it is also about not looking at learning as training. Many of you, so when I asked you the first question, most of us spoke about teacher and classroom and examination. So our traditional approach to learning assumes that you walk into a classroom, somebody who is who's the enlightened one, they sort of vomit, I'm sorry to use the word, but they sort of vomit gyan and enlightenment on you, and automatically you walk out of the room with a halo over your head. That is not reality, right? So if you look at today's world, how do you approach learning? Many organizations today are talking about the concept of the flipped classroom. The classroom being flipped upside down. What does that mean? Any guesses? Right.
There are teachers telling, guiding, or doing where these shortcomings are, that where you should make it. So then accordingly, you will be able to frame learning process.
Good point. So you are saying that understand what the person's level is and then tailoring. Okay. Any other guesses, thoughts? So how does, imagine when you were in school, and many of us, when I asked you that question, had nostalgic memories of school. So when you were in school, what happened in the classroom?
Teacher would come with a diary and take a class.
So teacher would walk in with the diary, they would write on the blackboard, they would teach you all these esoteric concepts, you would make notes, you would try to mug up concepts, and then before the teacher leaves the room, what does she do? Homework. And when do you do the homework? At home, right? You go back home and then you're applying all the concepts you learnt in the classroom. You're applying it and then you get stuck and you don't know what to do. Right? 2 plus 2. Right? That's how traditional learning worked. But when you talk about the flipped classroom, you're looking at learning very differently. What you're saying is, let the transfer of knowledge happen outside the classroom. Through video learning, through micro learning nuggets, through YouTube videos, through links to articles online. So let the knowledge transfer happen in a self-directed manner. Let the learner be in charge of the knowledge transfer. You give the learner the resources and he or she learns the concepts on their own. And then what do you do in the classroom? Homework. So you do your homework in the classroom. The actual application and reflection, that happens in the classroom. So the knowledge transfer happens outside the classroom and in a very self-directed way. We as learning professionals, very often we like to keep power very close to us. We don't want to let go, right? But now in today's day and age, what is the job of a learning professional? It's just to make learning resources available, the right resources available. Then leave it to the learner's discretion. Let learning be self-directed, and then formal learning has its place. In the classroom, what we do is apply, collaborate, learn from each other, reflect, make mistakes, get feedback, share feedback. All of that happens in the classroom. So your homework is now happening in the classroom. And the actual gyan sessions that your teachers used to give you, that happens when you're sitting in the bus or sitting in the car on your way home, whatever. Right? And that's why you have mobile learning, that's why you have social learning, that's why you have all these apps. You have MOOCs. MOOCs, is that a concept everybody is familiar with?
Massive
open online courses. How many of you have heard of MOOCs? Okay. So when you finish this session, even if you don't do anything else, however useless my session might be, I promise you that this is going to be a big takeaway for you. Please go Google www.coursera.org or edX, E-D-X. You will find hundreds of courses curated by Harvard, by Wharton, by all your fancy business schools all over the world. MIT has its courseware out there in the open. Learning is no longer held close to anybody's heart. It's out there, it's open. You can use it, you can access it, and it's free. So to do a course with a Wharton professor, with all those learning resources, a 3-month course or a 4-month course, you don't have to pay a penny. It's absolutely free. So it's just a matter of how is it that we as learning professionals get to know of these resources that are available, curate it. Because, you know, if you give somebody a big laundry list of programs, they are not going to be able to make sense of it. Understand what is the requirement of different target audiences, different learner populations in my organization, and then give them resources that they can choose whenever they want to, right? And MOOCs are just one example of that. So please, Coursera, C-O-U-R-S-E-R-A, Coursera. You also have another portal called edX, E-D-X. Yes, yes, that's right. So you can take a Wharton course or a Harvard course or whatever. The full course, you can submit assignments. There are discussion forums where you can interact with others who've opted for that course all over the world. You can have discussions. You'll even have group assignments, all of that. And then once you get certified, there is a process. There is an examination. There are assignments that you have to submit. There are credits you have to earn. And all of this is free. At the end of it, if you want a certificate, like you rightly said, only for that you have to pay a very nominal amount of money, few thousands. It's usually in the range of 2,000 to 10,000. If you pay that money, then you actually get a certificate from the university that you've done the course from, whether it's Wharton or whatever, right? But that is optional. You don't have to pay for the certification, because many times what you are interested in is world-class skill development. You don't really need that certificate. Yeah, employability. So if you look at it from the employability lens, obviously you need it. But many times you don't need to do that. So I'm just saying that it's free, it's out there, but we are not probably using it as much as we could. So in Piramal, what we recently did is, so we used to, in the last 2-3 years, we used to circulate these MOOC calendars. So we used to look at what are the requirements that people have and publish a quarterly MOOC calendar, saying that in all these MOOC forums, there are many more MOOC forums, by the way. Coursera and edX are just 2 examples. There's another one called UDEMY, right? There are many, many. So anyway, so in Piramal, what we did is we used to circulate these MOOC calendars to people and, you know, encourage them to take these courses. Many of them have taken it and they found it phenomenal. And you have courses on some of the most cutting-edge concepts, things like machine learning, artificial intelligence. We are all curious and, you know, we read in the media that, you know, thousands of jobs are going to be non-existent by 2020 because of things like machine learning, right? But many of us don't know what it means. So this is a good way to discover it and it's free. So we started circulating these MOOC calendars in the organization. Now what we are planning to do is to also give a small special allowance to people to encourage them to complete these courses. So what we are saying is, if you finish the course, and that in itself is very rigorous because it's usually 2-3 months, assignments, discussions, it's very rigorous. If you finish the course, if you complete the course and you want to apply for a certification, we will either subsidize it or pay for it depending on the threshold. So we've actually created a MOOC policy now so that we don't have to invest in getting facilitators who will come and give gyan. You don't have enough people to make a full batch. Why get into all of that, right? Today there are so many resources that are so accessible. So we are encouraging people to make use of this MOOC policy to do more self-directed learning. And I'm very confident that it is going to save my L&D budget. It's not going to add to my budget. It's actually going to save my budget, right? So that's something that's just an example of agile learning in action. Yeah?
Courses that you identify based on your business plan?
Yes. So, okay, the learning needs identification process. So I'm going to talk about that in a bit more detail.
For the MOOCs
also. So what we do is we have a process which I'll talk to you about to, you know, identify learning needs. It's not a perfect process. We are still experimenting with it and improving it every year. As part of that process, once we have the priorities identified for each of our businesses and at the group level, then we come up with these MOOC calendars. There is a MOOC calendar that is a standard repository, and then we customize it to the needs of each business as well. So that's what we do. I'll get into some of those details. I'm happy to share. It's not perfect. So there are still mistakes. It's still evolving, but I'm happy to share. Shall we move on?
So MOOC calendars are again available on online?
No, no. You have to. That is a job of a learning person, because there are so many websites. So the learning person's job is. Every through the year, any point of time you go to Coursera, you'll see hundreds of titles. You can search. Suppose I want to do a course on design thinking, or you know, even courses on leadership, any of that, or on manufacturing, on agile manufacturing, on sociology, on psychology, whatever you want to do. If you just search on that website, you will find 5 courses, one from Wharton, one from some unknown business school. You can choose which one you want to take, and it's all free. Imagine. So our job then is that of a learning curator. So what does my team do? They just curate the learning resources available. Once they've identified what the business wants, they look at different sources, and MOOC is just one source. MOOC is just an example. There are many such sources. They just curate learning resources. They don't have to spend that much time in designing it and reinventing the wheel, right? And that is the beauty of it. Otherwise, imagine a lot of learning professionals used to spend so much time on designing learning content. But now it is more about curating content, because content is already out there. Can you customize it? Can you contextualize it? Can you curate it? That's really the question. Not going to talk about VUCA. I think we are all convinced we are living in a VUCA world, right? Can you think of some companies that we all thought were destined to be one of the greatest companies out there, and then they quickly died out? Nokia, standard example. BlackBerry, absolutely. Kodak, yes. What happened in, so let's pick up some of these examples. Kodak, what do you think happened? What went wrong? And who invented digital photography?
Kodak.
And that is the irony of it. So digital photography was invented by somebody at Kodak, but they didn't see the value in it. And others leveraged the value in it, and it was too late for them to catch up.
But even the class which you have now, coding developed 15 years ago, this class.
Right. The Gorilla Glass or whatever.
Gorilla Glass. But 15 years, they had no usage. Finally, after 15 years, it came up. But coding developed 15 years.
Yeah.
Lying in the lab.
Yeah. What about which other company did we talk about? Nokia. What happened with Nokia? What did they not learn? What did they not pick up? That's me.
No, it was not Android actually. I think they choose to ignore. They knew that Steve Jobs was tinkering with, they had information from the patent office that there is something like iOS which is coming, smartphone, something like that. But they continue to believe that the technology, the market share, whatever they have, is the ultimate one, and is another nimble player. Who is
we are too big to fail, that's what they thought.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
We was too big to fail.
Yeah.
And that itself was the reason of their failure.
Correct. And what is interesting, so you've captured it very well, but what's also interesting is that they thought that the future of communication was voice. That was their strength, and they thought that the future of communication was voice. They were not agile enough to pick up the signals, and the organization didn't learn fast enough that the future of communication was actually data. They invested in hardware because they thought reliability of the phone is what is most important to the customer. They didn't invest in software, like you pointed out. They didn't do that. Right? So many, many such stories, but point being that we are in a world where things are unexpected. So you have to have your ears on the ground. things have to constantly evolve. Learning cannot be linear. Learning cannot be static. Learning cannot be standing in a classroom and delivering a session anymore. So you picked up the right companies that I put there as well. So this is actually interesting. If you see that timeline that I've put on the slide, if you look at different milestones in the human story, look at the difference, the gap, the number of years that it took from one big milestone to the other. And now look what's happening. So between the internet and the human genome sequencing, it's taken only 9 years. Okay, so now that I've given you a lot of gyan, I shall talk about some of our experiences from Piramal, both good and bad, both the good things, the things that worked as well as the things that did not. Okay? So this is, if you look at agile learning as a concept, there are four elements that you will need to look at, four lenses from which you need to look at agile learning to make your organization an agile organization. The first is really the culture. No matter, you know, whether you have millions and millions of rupees and dollars to spend on learning, if your culture is not one that encourages risk-taking, that encourages failure. I can't remember which company it is, but there's a company which has its slogan as fail fast. So that basically encapsulates their culture. So they are encouraging people to take risks, to make mistakes, but don't make costly mistakes. Fail fast, right? So which company was that? Fail fast? I can't remember. Google. Okay. Yeah. So agile culture is really about the fact that unless your organization has a culture where you're encouraged to take risks, make mistakes, unless there's a focus on learning, if the focus is only on the here and now, on results being delivered as of yesterday, and not on long-term learning and development, if your managers are not setting aside time to have conversations with their team around development, then no matter how many dollars and rupees you spend on your learning budget, nothing is going to happen, right? The other big piece, and I heard somebody here talk about it, is job rotation. It's also a big element of an agile culture. Are you willing to move people or are you going to keep them in silos for the rest of their working lives? That's a very important part of building an agile culture. That's very, very important. Moving on to agile learning resources. Agile learning resources, I've spoken to you about it. So rather than depending on traditional classroom training, instructor-led training, can you actually have agile learning resources, whether it is video learning, micro learning bites. Nobody has the time to sit for 1 hour in one day in a classroom or 2 days in a classroom. When you're traveling in your commute, if I can have a 3-minute video that explains some concept relevant to my work, that's good enough for me. I don't have the patience to sit through hours and hours of content anymore, right? And today, if you look at your workforce, that is also changing. The demographics of your workforce is also changing dramatically. By 2020, more than half of your workforce in most of our companies is going to be millennials. And millennials don't have the patience to sit in a classroom for days and hours. You have to deliver learning resources to them in real time. And that's where technology, therefore, becomes a very important part of what the learning function has to do. Agile learning needs, I'll talk about this and how we are experimenting with this. It's about learning needs identification not being an annual static exercise. Once again, it has to be an iterative process. The learning person therefore plays the role almost of a performance consultant. So if a business leader comes to you and says, hey, can you deliver this training program for me? I want to do a training program. My people are not taking ownership. Can you do an ownership skills training? I'm telling you, I've got requests like this. Ownership training. I wish I could put people into a classroom and teach them to take ownership. I don't think anybody's invented that yet, right? So a learning professional has to actually have the courage to push back, have the courage to probe and understand when the person says, I want you to deliver a training on ownership. What does he really mean? What is the issue? So act like a performance consultant, ask the right questions, Maybe the solution lies in structure. Maybe the solution lies in process. Maybe the solution lies in leadership. Maybe the solution lies in how the team works together. And training, traditional training may have nothing to do with it. And therefore, the learning professional needs to approach those situations with an open mind and act like a performance consultant. That's a big, big shift. And that is something that many of us, including me, we all struggle with it. Because it's very tempting, very easy when a senior leader comes to you and says, deliver this for me. Yes, sir, I'll do it. That's the standard response, the safest response. But those days are over. If you want your learning to be impactful and relevant, you have to think like a consultant, right? So the learning needs peace, agile learning needs. Therefore, that's a big part of the whole process. An annual training needs identification process won't cut it. Agile learning effectiveness. So we spoke about how do you measure the impact of learning. Your level 1, level 2, level 3, reaction, behavior change, all of that. Knowledge transfer, and then of course ROI. So that is your standard framework, but some of it may no longer be as simple and straightforward. So we'll talk about that as well. Okay. Now I'm going to share some of our some of what we do, and please feel free to stop me at any point and ask questions. Please feel free. So I'm just giving you some examples of agile culture in action. When I walked into Piramal, one thing that struck me was that we have our core values displayed everywhere, and every organization has it. So one of our core values is around expertise. The other is around innovation. So we have four values: knowledge, action, care, and impact. Impact is a fourth value that got recently added. Knowledge, action, care, and impact. Now, how we explain knowledge is in terms of expertise and innovation, right? Action is in terms of entrepreneurship. So if you look at our values, expertise, innovation, and entrepreneurship are big parts of who we are. And this is an organization where you see it being displayed in action as well. It doesn't get restricted to being displayed on the wall. That is very important. The kind of values that your organization has. Does it value risk taking? Does it value expertise? Or is it only about results in the short term? That's very, very important. Now, how do you actually make those values come alive? That's very important. You might have very fancily termed values displayed on the wall. But do your practices and processes actually make that come alive? Do you have signature practices that actually illustrate those values? So for instance, if entrepreneurship is one of your values, what do you have from an employee experience standpoint for him to believe that entrepreneurship is actually a value? You might write it in a nice font, but why will he believe it, right? So what we try to do is something like this. So what we did is we have something called an elevator pitch that we do for, hi Andy. So we have something called an elevator pitch that we do for some of our middle management high potentials. So the purpose of the Piramal group is doing well and doing good. So there's a business angle to it and a social angle to it. What we did is we told our young, smart high potentials that you pick up one of these two streams, either doing well or doing good. You pick up any idea that you want, a business idea or a social idea. You come up with a business plan. We'll help you iterate it. We'll give you feedback. We'll coach you. And then the best ideas get presented to the chairman for funding. So that's something that we actually did last year, and we are repeating it this year as well. So we had a lot of great ideas. Many of them were completely unrelated to the sectors that we operate in. But we did give it a hearing because that's important to build that sort of culture. So we did that, and we picked up two ideas, one of which is actually now in the process of being fleshed out. I need help with my slides, please. Yeah. Thank you. Absolutely. Right, so just an example. So the one of the ideas that is now close to being implemented is this Piramal app for a cause. So basically an app which is like the Uber of the social world. You book your cabs on an Uber, but similarly can you choose whether I want to teach in a government school nearby or mentor some young girl students on life skills. So I can choose what social skills I want to actually you know, spend my time on. So it's like Uber, but in the social space. So that's an idea that you know, one of our high potentials came up with, and we funded it, and it's actually work in progress now.
Is he driving it?
He is driving it. So right now, he's actually doing it over and above his day job. Once it reaches a certain level of maturity, then we've also spoken to the CEO of that company to see if he can be moved out to lead this initiative independently. We've also given him a mentor. So Piramal has a Piramal Foundation, which has about 4,000 employees. So the CEO of that foundation is his mentor. The guy who's worked on this idea is from a very different business, but the CEO of the foundation, Piramal Foundation, is the mentor for this guy. And additionally, there's an external mentor also who is savvy with technology, who's helping him in the whole fleshing out of this idea. So that's the support that the organization is given. So this is just an example of how do you actually make your values come alive, right? And this year we are about to launch, actually we've launched it, we are waiting for the ideas to come in, the second cohort. And here I'll tell you what the struggle has been. The struggle has been, suppose somebody in my team who's a young, high potential comes up with a brilliant idea, will I as a manager be willing to give him the time to spend on fleshing it out? That becomes the biggest challenge. And that's why the culture of the organization, the sponsorship that you have from senior leaders, that comes into the picture. So in our case, we have very clear sponsorship, and that's why this guy was able to set aside time to work on his passion project, so to speak. Another example. So what we realized is that we have a lot of young millennials, young people who've joined the workforce, but our senior leadership team was consisted of people who've spent most of their lifetime working for the Piramal Group. And many of them thought that, you know, I have so many years of experience under my belt. Now it's my turn to cascade learning to younger people. But there was not a lot of openness to receiving learning, right, given their age, given their experience. So what we did is interesting. So we experimented with something called Piramal Connect. It is a two-way collaborative mentoring program. Many of you would have heard of reverse mentoring as a concept. Yeah? How many of you have heard of reverse mentoring? Would you like to share, anybody? What does it mean?
Yesterday only we discussed about this topic, one speaker.
Oh, okay. Absolutely. So many organizations have started doing that, the concept of reverse mentoring. What we wanted to do was slightly different. We wanted to convey a simple message that learning can come from anywhere, and learning is always two-way, it is not one-way. So what we did is we made a two-way collaborative mentoring program called Piramal Connect. So a senior leader is mapped to a high potential, a young high potential at the middle management level. The high potential mentors the senior leader, and the senior leader also mentors the high potential. Each of them have goals that they want to achieve through the relationship, and we actually do a shaadi.com sort of matching of the profiles. So once people apply, and that's why I said the big job of the learning person is just curation. Curation of learning resources, curation of people resources sometimes. So if I know that Mr. X needs to learn how to build a social media presence and Mr. Y needs to learn XYZ, then I bring them together. That's my job, right? And here we've also experimented with something. It's a little early to tell you whether it's working or not. I can share some anecdotal evidence. So we thought long and hard about whether we should track the progress of those mentoring sessions, sit on the mentors, both the mentors. We don't call them mentor and mentee because, you know, it's an egalitarian relationship. Both are mentors. The young guy is also a mentor, the big guy is also a mentor. So we thought, should the team sit and fix appointments for these guys and track how many of them have met how many times and blah, blah, blah. Then we realized, no, what's the point? Then it'll again be seen as being pushed down people's throats. That's the other point. Learning is no longer about push. It is about pull, right? So we let it loose. It was very tough for us, but we let go. we trained people on the skills that they needed to have a successful mentoring relationship. But after that, we told them that you continue it if you find it useful. If you don't find it useful, it's okay. Don't meet each other. That's fine. Right? That's what we did. So currently, we have 22 mentoring partnerships in action, of which I think about 3 or 4 died out in the last 4 or 5 months. Somehow, there was no chemistry between the two mentors. They didn't make time. They didn't think this was a priority. So it didn't happen. But the others are still meeting. Some of them may have met 8 times. Some of them may have met only 2 times. But they are meeting, and they will continue to meet as long as they see the value in that relationship. So that's the decision that we took. The only thing that we are doing is doing quarterly check-in sessions with both groups separately to understand what are their challenges. So do the young guys feel that the senior leaders are closed and they are not listening to them at all? Do they have the confidence to say that, hey, I might be young, but I know what I'm talking about and I can help you? Right? So we are helping them along those lines. We are just facilitating the process. We are not tracking it. We are not shoving it down their throats. Right? So that's, I think, a brave decision that we've taken. It's a little early for me to tell you whether it's worked. It seems to be working, but maybe another 4 or 5 months down the line, we'll be in a better position to tell you that. Yeah. So we've left it open. They can meet during office hours, after office hours, up to them. They are not from the same business. And that's, again, because we want to build that culture where, the silos get broken. One is the silo of hierarchy, but also the silo of business, location, etc. Some of those relationships are also cross-country. So for instance, I have a president who sits in Mumbai who's mentoring a young high potential sitting in a Mopeth plant in the United Kingdom. I have somebody in Canada who is working with somebody in Digwal near Hyderabad. So we have all of those weird things in place. And I think that is where the value of this whole initiative comes in. If you don't inject diversity into this whole process, if you do a like-to-like sort of matching, then it doesn't make sense. So we've done it that way. It is cross-business. Any other questions?
Ma'am, how will the success of, like, you also discussed books?
Yes.
How many percentage of
Reverse mentoring. So reverse mentoring, like I said, out of the 22 that we started with, we have, I think, 19 that are currently active and thriving. Whether they will thrive for the full period of the mentoring relationship, which is 12 months, I don't know. Now, the other piece is after the formal 12-month process, when we close it formally from our side, many of them may continue to meet and mentor each other, right? Organically, that may also continue. So I think as of now, it does look successful. So 19 out of 22 is not a bad ratio. It's a good ratio. Given that we are not forcing people to meet or anything of that sort, it's a good ratio. Your other question was on MOOCs. MOOCs globally have a completion rate of roughly around 1%. Because remember, it's free. When it is free, everybody wants to log in. There is a sense of curiosity. They start taking some professor's session. They start reading some of those articles. Then the assignments come. I don't have time, and then people don't complete it. So the completion rate globally is close to 1.5%. We've started tracking it, but it is not perfect yet because MOOCs are through different websites. So employees need not report back to us whether they've completed. So we don't have a tracking process yet for MOOCs. But now with the MOOC policy that we are releasing, I think we will have greater visibility. Because if people actually complete the MOOCs, they'll want to get a certification because the company is paying for it, right? So now that we are launching this policy, I think we'll be able to track those metrics better. Otherwise, it's more free-flowing in that sense.
But the reward will be which one? Is that besides certification?
Mm-hmm.
Is it some terms of career? I mean, what kind of a reward? Person will do certification. One is who's curious. That is one aspect of people who could do it.
Right.
The others who are not curious.
Right.
But you want them to also update themselves.
Right.
How will you reward them? In terms of, is there any reward mechanism for them?
There is no reward mechanism. So if you look at our performance management process, one of the 4 elements of your KRAs is linked to learning and growth for the individual. And this obviously could find place there. But there is no tangible reward. The tangible reward is the fact that the organization is willing to pay for your certification from a fancy B school if you actually take the effort of completing the course. That's where it is now.
No, but in the PMS, learning and growth is a...
That is one
that
of
is,
the... Yes,
saying,
that
is also
one
there.
Of the... It's a usual BSc approach. I know that the world is moving away from BSc now. BSc is also seen now as being too limiting, but we still follow the BSc, and one of the four dimensions of the BSc is obviously learning and growth.
I think success of control the curator.
Absolutely.
If it is there, then all other processes will follow. You don't have to. So first you start with the curator next.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Hi. Good morning. I would like to understand, how do you identify the mentoring need and also the strength of the hypers and the seniors? Thanks.
So, little bit of context. So, we have two flagship programs. Middle management level, we have a flagship program where we identify our high potentials in partnership with Andy's company. So, Aon works with us on the identification of our high potentials through a flagship program called Ascent. Similarly, for the senior leadership group, we have a similar program called Summit, right? Now, what we've tried to do is to connect these two talent pools, the Ascent talent pool of high potentials at middle management and your Summit talent pool. Now, through the assessment process itself, we know each person's strengths and development areas. They've had lots of feedback, lots of coaching that's happened to them. Each of them know what are their areas of greatness that they need to build. They also know what their learning edges are. So it's all there, it's structured, it's documented. But at the same time, we give them the freedom to choose what is the area they'd like to be mentored on. By the end of the whole assessment process, there's already a great deal of self-awareness. But we still don't tell them that this is what you need to be mentored on. We let them choose. Shall I move on? How much time do I have? 20 minutes. Auntie, I hope I don't bore you to death. 15 minutes. Super. So I'm going to just quickly talk about some of these other things you see on the stage, on the screen. So Galileo project, this is something that we've just started doing. So this is actually, so what we realized is, again, VUCA, your standard buzzword that we just spoke about. Things are changing, you know, especially in the technology space. There are so many startups that are coming up, and there are so many path-breaking ideas that are out there, which we are not fully leveraging. Many of us have no clue about what is happening from a technology standpoint in supply chain or logistics, and how many rupees it could, you know, save for some of our businesses. So here, what we are trying to do is, how do we actually seed innovation, both product innovation and process innovation, into our businesses? And that's what we've called as a Galileo project. So we've just initiated it. What we are doing is, we are doing a startup fair, right? So we are planning a startup fair sometime end of this month, in end of June. We are inviting, so our strategy team is working with us to identify a set of startups, upcoming startups, that have some sort of vague linkage to the businesses that we are in. We are piloting this with one of our businesses, which is a B2C business, the consumer products business, which has brands like lactocalamine, Saridon, iPill, etc. So we are working with that business. We are doing a pilot for now. What we are doing is, we are inviting all these startups to come in and make their pitches, talk about their value proposition. Then we are going to let the business leaders, along with our middle management high potentials, decide which of those ideas are worth piloting. Right? Suppose I figure out that there's one idea in the logistics space that could potentially really help me, or one idea in the supply chain space, or a sales-related thing. Then the high-potential team, along with the business leaders in the consumer products business, the plan is to formulate groups. So you will have two high-potentials and 2 to 3 people from the business working with each of those startups to pilot that idea and then see if it works for the consumer products business. So this is one thought that we are currently exploring. The idea is to bring in outside-in thinking into the business, and also to make sure that we are not missing out on all the action out there, especially in the technology space. We've also done something similar for our financial services business. So we did something, but it was not as structured. The idea came from there, and now we are trying to pilot it in a more structured manner for the consumer products business. So again, I'm just going back to, again, the role of a learning professional. It's really about some of these things. It's not about delivering classroom, about learning needs identification in the traditional sense anymore. Okay. So the other way we also bring in outside-in thinking for our senior leaders is through leader connects. So we invite a lot of external speakers to come in and talk to our senior leaders as well as our middle and junior management high potentials. So they get to hear from people from very, very different fields. So we do monthly sessions. For our high potentials, we have had a lot of senior leaders, some of our board members, etc., coming in, interacting with them. And that really helps in bringing in that outside-in thinking. So this is, again, something that we do quite religiously, the leader connect. Like I said, Galileo project is something that is still in pilot mode. These are, again, just some examples. You know, we spoke about how do you actually embed learning into real life. Learning cannot be plucking somebody from their work and putting them in a classroom. It has to be embedded into their everyday life, right? So some of the things that we've been experimenting with is, we've all heard about augmented reality and virtual reality and all of that. It sounds very fancy, but it's quite simple. So we are actually experimenting with this free app. So there is this free, you should look at Zapworks. It's a website. They also have a free app. There's a Zap code in which you can embed videos, you can embed images. So we recently did a management trainee induction program. We had a new batch of management trainees coming in, and they wanted to discover more about the Piramal group. Rather than giving them a download session, what we did is we put Zap codes all over the classroom in different parts of the office. They could move around, use the app, and the moment they scanned the Zap code, then, you know, you see a video of somebody speaking. You have different resources which are embedded in those Zap codes. So it's, again, virtual reality, not in its full form, but still, it is augmented reality in a sense. And it is, again, free. So you can thank me for all the free resources that I'm pointing you to. The other stuff is, again, standard. So we've also been experimenting with gamification. Remember, we spoke about the flipped classroom. In the classroom, there's no longer knowledge transfer. It's all about practice. It's all about getting feedback and, you know, trying out your skill, the new skill that you've learned along with others. That's where we leverage partners like Nolscape, like NParadigm. What we do is these guys have very, very interesting simulations on things like P&L statements. How do you actually, you know, financial statements. Financial statements are very harrowing for many people. NParadigm works with us to deliver a program which uses a set of simulations for people to learn how to interpret financial ratios and statements, etc. Similarly, we use Nolscape for a lot of simulations around situational leadership, etc. Instead of giving people gyan about situational leadership, if you actually get them to experiment, play the role of a team leader, managing a team in real life, you earn points, you earn badges. We all like rewards, right? The brain is wired to like rewards. So that's where we use a lot of gamification as well. Okay, you will wonder why I've put Fitbit up there. How is Fitbit relevant to learning? Any guesses? How many of you use a Fitbit?
Immediate feedback,
yeah. How many of you use a Fitbit? Is there anybody here who uses a Fitbit? Okay. Why do you like wearing it? It keeps track of your health and fitness. Okay. Heart rate. So it keeps giving you feedback on how you're doing. When you complete 10,000 steps, what does it do? It congratulates you, right? It will start vibrating, it will start flashing, and you feel good. Now, once that happens once, what will you do when you're sitting in your office? If you have to go to the printer and pick up, you know, printout, you will probably take the longer route there. Or if you're waiting for your food to get heated up in the microwave, you will do this, because you know that, you know, I'm adding to my steps and maybe I'll get that, you know, that shake from my Fitbit, right? So what is that really all about? So, Yeah. So Fitbit is actually just about behavioral psychology. We are human beings. We like rewards. We like being acknowledged for our efforts. And we like real-time feedback as well. So it just uses all of those principles. So if you look at, you know, fitness as a skill with losing weight or building muscle as an outcome, then Fitbit is actually a learning application in that sense. And I'm just saying that the same concept can be used in many different ways. For instance, for leadership development, there is a similar app which uses principles very similar to Fitbit, right? So what they do is, again, it's a peer group that you work with. You can compare yourself with them. You can share feedback with them. Every day, there is an assignment that you have to do, an assignment that is very small, but it is linked to one behavioral change that you need to make, right? And it's usually a 6-month or 12-month journey. There is a leaderboard, so you know how you are doing versus the others in your peer group. Let's say that 30 of my senior leaders are part of that group. Then I know that Mr. X has made this much progress and therefore earned 30 points, whereas I have earned only 5. How does it look? You know, my CEO is looking at that leaderboard. Let me actually put in a little more effort. So I'm just saying that whole competition, looking at metrics, rewards, all of those elements from a behavioral psychology, neuroscience lens, they all sound very fancy, but they are actually simple things that are readily available today.
These are reinforcements, basically.
Yeah, reinforcements. And you're basically building a habit. So in Fitbit also, you're trying to build a habit. And similarly, if you look at leadership development, in many ways, we are trying to build new habits and trying to change old ones. So some of these things work very well in that context. Building rewards, building real-time feedback, these are things that work very powerfully. Somebody asked me about agile learning needs. How do we actually do the learning needs identification process? So a quick glimpse of that, this is again evolving, it's not a perfect process and it's fairly new as well, it's only 2 years old. What we do is, so traditionally the way we used to do learning needs identification about 3 years ago was through the performance management process. So in the performance management process, what happens? Every manager rates their employee and says, Mr. X needs to get presentation skills training, Mr. Y needs to get communication skills training, then it becomes a full kichdi. Then the poor HR guy is trying to collate all of those needs. Then he is going to the training guy and saying, listen, I have 20 people who need communication skills training. Can you make a batch for me? Then you're struggling to get people into the classroom. It's like that, right? We were doing that. And we realized, what's the point? You know, you're trying to track T&I completion and coverage. And what's the point? Nobody cares. The poor guy wanted to be trained on, he wanted to build his confidence, but instead we put him in a classroom and forced him to learn presentation skills. That's what typically happens, right? So what we decided 2 years ago is learning needs have to be linked to the business plan and the business strategy of the business and the group. The learner experience, how you deliver learning, that can be bottom up. So our thinking right now is that learning needs are top down. It cannot be bottom up. But the learner experience, that is something that we design as learning professionals, and that is bottom up. I'll explain what I mean. So what we do for learning needs identification is, once the annual budgeting cycle happens for all the businesses, we then spend time with the CEO and his XCOM, the executive committee, the leadership team. There is something that happens called the Business Learning Council. So we talk about what are the business priorities for the year, and therefore, linked to those business priorities, are there capability needs that we need to address? Are there new capabilities that we need to build? Are there gaps in capability that we need to bridge? Is there talent that we need to infuse from outside? So some of those conversations have started happening. And we've realized that just creating that forum is very, very powerful. Just the fact that the CEO and his direct reports are sitting in a room and discussing the learning needs of the business, that in itself is very, very powerful. What it also does is, it gets a lot of sponsorship for you for delivering learning interventions. Otherwise, who cares whether you do a communication skills program? Does your CEO really care? But the moment you make it the CEO's agenda, then it shifts. And people down the line also start taking learning seriously. Your managers start realizing that I need to make time for my people to learn and grow. So this is something that's been working quite well for us. So what we are currently doing is we have a group talent council which looks at our high potentials and their career moves, succession for our senior leaders, etc. And in addition, looks at the group learning agenda from a leadership development lens. Then we have the business learning councils which pick up the two or three big learning priorities which are relevant for the business. And then in some of our manufacturing businesses, we also have site learning councils, which, and we give the site learning councils some leeway to add and customize some stuff that is more relevant to the site. So that is how we've now structured our learning interventions. What we've also done is we've made the very tough choice of putting no learning intervention on our learning plan unless it has a senior leader who is a vice president or president who is going to sponsor it. Unless I have a sponsor who is identified, who is willing to put his neck on the line, saying that this is my initiative, I will work to drive this, I will work to design this, and I will work to measure impact. We don't put it on the plan. So this has obviously been a very tough decision for us to make. We still do ad hoc sessions. It's not that we are perfect. But I'm just saying that when we do the learning plan for the year, we've put our foot down and said, nothing goes on the learning plan unless there's a learning sponsor. Ad hoc stuff comes in through the year, but even for that, we need a sponsor. So that's how we've been approaching this. And I think it's been working very, very well. So for most of our learning interventions, the leader sits with you, helps you understand the context, works with you on designing the learning journey, the learning intervention itself, comes into the different sessions, is a part of virtual sessions, gives you feedback. So the whole iterative feedback piece that we spoke about, that happens because the leader is giving you real-time feedback through the whole process, right? And impact is measured not just at the end, but you're actually looking at progress, you're incorporating feedback. So it's working quite well, the sponsor concept. Blue collar? We do. So we have interventions for the blue collar workers as well, and it is locally driven by the sites. So the site learning councils that... Say that again? No. Manufacturing sites. So if you look at that hierarchy, there is a group learning council, there's a business learning council. For the manufacturing businesses, because they have manufacturing sites and factories, they have a site learning council as well, which looks at the learning needs of the particular site. So the blue collar workers' needs usually come up in the site learning council. You mean in terms of the learning councils? So what we do is very simple. It's just a conversation. Like I said, the fact that you have that platform, that is very powerful. You're getting the site leadership team in one place, the site head and his HODs in one room. You're getting them together. You're telling them that these are the needs that have come from the business. This is what your CEO and your senior leadership team of the business have said we should do for the site. Is there anything else that you need to do that is site specific? What is the site's business plan for the year in order to deliver that? Again, same thing. What are the gaps we need to address? What are the new skills we need to build? That's what we do. And for everything that we do at the local site level, the site head or the HOD has to be a sponsor. So if it is at the business level, it has to be a VP or a president within the business. If it's at the site level, then it has to be one of the site leadership team members.
Yeah. Ma'am, what you are talking is quite different and very attractive.
Who's,
one.
I can't.
I am here.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. What you are talking is very different and very attractive one. You must be following this for last 3-4 years. What is the actual business impact? Has business grown multifold times because of these initiatives?
So I'll give you, I think, the best way to measure impact. Sometimes, you know, if you look at it in a fragmented manner, it doesn't really make sense. So if you look at Piramal, the share price of Piramal is a good example of the overall value of the group, right? So I think 1 year ago, our share price was roughly around 1400 rupees, 1300 or 1400 rupees. Currently, I think today the share price must be close to 2,900 in 1 year. And obviously, we are not taking credit for it. but we are just saying that the job of learning as a function is to enable business to grow and to be there in real time to deliver learning needs. That we are trying to do. We are not perfect. There are lots of breaks in the process still. But we are growing, and if you have to grow exponentially, then there is no way that learning can operate in a linear, traditional manner. That's something that we've discovered, and we've discovered through our mistakes. 2 years ago, we had a bottom-up process, training needs, training calendar, that's what we had. And we are still evolving, it's still not a perfect process, but I think it's working very well. And what we also do is, we measure impact now, not overall in terms of learning needs, coverage, etc. We measure impact for each learning intervention. So for instance, I think I have a slide on it. So Lucid that you see there, it's actually a communication program. 2 years ago or 3 years ago, we would have delivered a classroom communication program. What we did because of this approach is that we realized that the real challenge was customer centricity. Our people at our manufacturing locations in our factories, they were not able to communicate with our clients effectively. And because of that, our clients did not have a favorable impression of the organization. Many of our clients are people from different parts of the world. So you have the Pfizers of the world and the Sanofis of the world. You have people from different parts of the globe coming in, visiting the site, talking to some of these people over teleconferences, WebEx sessions, audio calls, emails, and their experience is not positive. That was the problem statement. Now, traditional thinking would have told us, do a communication skills program. Initially, we were actually told, do an English grammar program for our people at the site. Can you believe it? We were told that our clients are saying that your people are not able to communicate, so can you do an English grammar program? That's what we were told. But when we drilled down, what we realized is that the problem is in the customer experience. How do we actually fix the customer experience? So what we did is we created three tracks, Lucid 1, Lucid 2, and Lucid 3. Lucid 1 is for your basic people, your junior management folks, who will have email communication and maybe telephonic communication with the client. Lucid 2 is for people who will take the client along for site visits, who will have face-to-face meetings with the client, etc. And Lucid 3 is for your business development folks and your program management people who have a much more deeper relationship with the customer. And what we did is we created a 4-month learning journey for them, which had multiple sessions. And we did this internally. So we did a train the trainer model. We trained people as Lucid trainers. And the Lucid trainers would work with a cohort of people. So suppose I'm a Lucid trainer. For that 4 months, I work with a group of, say, 15 or 20 people. And I take them through that entire chain. And what I teach them is real time. I teach them, how do you write an effective email? How do you actually talk to a client from the United Kingdom who's come in about the weather? People can't do that. These are the real challenges. It's not about knowing what is an adjective or an adverb, right? What will you do with that knowledge? So what we actually did is teach them very simple things. We did, we started listening into the conversations, the client calls that the team did. We were just silent listeners on those calls. And then we gave them feedback. After the calls, we made feedback reports, we had debrief conversations with the teams, we gave them written reports. So the Lucid journey encompasses these sort of elements which are embedded in the real work experience of these guys. So you are not saying that learning is something that is outside of work. It is embedded in your work, in your everyday work. The more you do that, the more traction you will get. So Lucid is now something that business has asked us to do again for this year, for a different set of sites because it's worked well last year. For something like this, imagine your ROI, how will you measure it? You look at customer satisfaction scores. The CSI index, I can't remember the numbers offhand. So for the Lucid program, I think 2 or 3 cohorts that we did in some of the sites. For some of the others, we didn't have CSI data available. But there is a clear difference in the customer satisfaction index. And if you show that sort of ROI, then you don't have to justify to business why they need to invest in learning, right? Just an example. Any last questions? So let's quickly revisit some of those 2-3 questions that we spoke about. So when you think about learning, what comes to your mind now? Self-learning. Okay. Sorry? Reverse learning. Okay, how do you measure the impact of learning? Shareholder returns. Yeah. And how will you actually do your learning needs identification? linked to the business, be embedded with the business, right? So like I said, the best way of doing learning needs identification. So in the Lucid context, the way we did it is, we sat in on those calls, the client calls. We looked at their emails. That's the best way of doing learning needs identification. Any last questions? Andy is cursing me, I know. Thank you so much for your patience. Indu has my email ID, so if you have any questions, if you want to reach out with any questions, if you have any feedback or ideas for us that we could implement, please reach out to me. Thank you so much.
Thank you.